All praises belong to Allah. All praises belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Lord of all the worlds. We seek refuge in Allah from the evil of our souls and the evil of our deeds. Whoever Allah leads astray, no one can guide him. And whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala misguides, no one can guide him. Continuing where we left off in the chapter of Iman, Sahih al-Bukhari, the chapter, Bab, the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. And that if two parties from among the believers fight one another, then make reconciliation between them. فَسَمَاهُمُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he named them believers. Even though they fight each other, he still named them believers. And Abi Bakrata radiallahu ta'ala anhu qala sami'tu Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yaqulu idha ittaqa muslimani bisayfihima falqatilu wal maqtulu fi an-nar qultu ya Rasulullah hadha alqatilu fama ba'alu al-maqtuli qala innahu kana harisan ala qatli sahibihi. Abi Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, may Allah be pleased with him, he said he heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say that when two Muslims meet each other with their weapons, they say fehima, and the fighter, the one who killed the person, and the maqtul, the one who was murdered, is in the fire. He said, O Messenger of Allah, it's understood why the murderer, the one who killed the other person, is in the fire. But why the one who murdered? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that he was adamant, he was diligent about trying to kill the other person. Ibn al-Hajr, rahimahullah, he said that Imam al-Bukhari is using this hadith to show that a believer commits sins, and this doesn't make him a kafir. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he still called them believers. Imam al-Nawawi, about the verse where it says two groups, he said, a group here refers to two small group of Muslims. And sometimes a group can refer to one person. Allah called them believers in this verse. And after their fight, he called them brothers. After their fighting, he referred to them as brothers. The Prophet's words, both the murderer and the murdered will go to hell. Imam al-Nawawi said this means they deserve to go to hell. This means they deserve to go to hell. Shaykh al-Islam, Zakariya al-Ansari, al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah, he said, this wording proves if a person has the firm will and resolve to commit the sin in his heart and is determined to carry it out, he will do so. He will do so. And in this case, it shows us the importance of the intention. A benefit we get from this hadith is that it is haram, it is prohibited to fight Muslims. We shouldn't fight each other. It is haram. Another benefit from this hadith, it shows the permissibility to return back to the imam, to return back to your teacher, to return back to Ahlul Ilm, to return back to the scholars. Because he said, okay, Ya Rasulullah, هذا القاتل فما بال المقتول. Okay, we can see why the murderer is going to go to hell, but why the murder? What is his sin? And the Prophet explained to him that he was ardent, he was stern, he had a firm resolution in his heart to kill his companions. So here the Sahaba, Abi Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he went back to the Prophet and asked him the questions. Also, this hadith, it shows the importance of the niyyah, the importance of the intention in the heart. And it also shows the danger of the niyyah if a person has the will, if the person has the desire to kill another person or commit a sin. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with sincere intentions. The next hadith is the chapter Dhulmun Duna Dhulmun. Oppression is of lesser degrees is of different stages. An Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala anhu an an-nabiy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qalat lamma nazalat alladhina amanu lam yalbisu imanahum bi dhulm. قال أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أيهنا لم يظلم فأنزل الله إن الشرك لظلم عظيم. And Abdullah bin Mas'ud رضي الله تعالى عنه, he narrated the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said, when the verse was revealed, those who don't mix their iman with dhulm, with oppression. And the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet, they said, which one from amongst us does not commit oppression? فَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. Then Allah sent down the verse, إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. That verily shirk is dhulm. Badr al-Din al-Aini, he said, this hadith here is to show the Muslims that dhulm, it varies. Dhulm, it varies. This chapter here refutes the Khawarij. The Khawarij. Those people who believe that a sinner will go to hell. Imam al-Bukhari is trying to show us how kufr varies, how you have minor kufr and then you have major kufr. Compared to the hadith we took last week, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he referred to the acts of the women who are ungrateful to their husband as having kufr. And that all kufr, it doesn't expel one out of Islam. And then likewise, Imam al-Bukhari is following it up with dhulm, with oppression. So here we have two types of kufr, and now we have two types of dhulm. Ibn Rajab, he said that dhulm, it varies. Dhulm, it varies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. That verily shirk is the greatest of oppressions. وَقَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى وَالْكَافِرُونَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. And the disbelievers, hum al-zalimun. They are the zalimun. Dhulm, linguistically, it means to place something in its improper place. And the greatest misappropriation, the greatest thing placed in its incorrect place, is to place creation in the place of the Creator. This hadith, it shows us that sins weaken iman. Sins weaken iman. Imam Shaykh al-Islam Zakariya al-Ansari said this hadith, it shows us that disobedience isn't called shirk and dhulm is of different levels. The Sahaba, they had a concern and they asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he clarified it. This is a principle in usul al-fiqh, takhir al-bayan and haja la yajuz. Takhir al-bayan and waqt al-haja la yajuz. To delay clarifying something beyond its required time is not permissible. It's not permissible. Soon as they asked the Prophet ﷺ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the answer to their questions about what oppression mean. Dhulm, we have three kinds. The first one is shirk, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala something else or someone else. Two, to oppress another person. Dhulm is oppression. Oppress another person by attacking him physically, by harming him mentally, by taking his right unjustly. And another form of dhulm is when you oppress yourself. When you oppress yourself. If a person is free of shirk, but falls into any of these acts of oppression, meaning he oppresses another person by attacking him physically, he abuses another Muslim mentally, he takes his wealth unjustly. If he has any of these, it shows that his iman is weak. It shows that his iman is weak. But he is still a believer, he is still a Muslim, and he is under the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah, if he decides to punish him based on the according or based on the amount of the dhulm he did to others, then Allah will do so. Or if he decides to forgive him, then he has the right to do so. Kufr and dhulm is major and minor. Sins are of two types. Sins are connected to the rights of others, and it is connected to the rights of oneself. This hadith, it teaches us the importance of reading the Quran and contemplating over its meaning. Because Allah, He said, أَلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِمَانَهُمْ بِالظُّلْمِ. those who believe and they don't mix their iman with dhulm. So off the face value, off the clear cut meaning of this ayat, that dhulm here, placing something in its proper place, all of us commit it. So it wouldn't be correct. But we should understand the Quran based on the way the Salaf understood the Quran. When we have ayats of dhulm, when we have ayats of kufr and fisq and disobedience, then we return back to the understanding of the Salaf al-Saleh. Shirk is the greatest of sins. Shirk is the greatest of sins. The next point, this hadith teaches us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He forgives everything except shirk, and there are various kinds of oppression. And the last one, the last benefit we take from this hadith is that when there is something that we don't understand, when something causes us doubt, when something causes us confusion, then we should return to Ahlul Ilm. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika.